Велика честь для нас бути тут, в привітному місті, в італійському дворику. Ми таке ніколи не робили, хоча міський голова каже, що в принципі тут кожного дня якась така подія, але не аж така подія. І ми це, будучи львів'янами, по-перше, ми можемо розказати, як це було. Я думаю, що львів'яни це зрозуміють, львівський стиль в чомусь, менеджменту в тому числі. Now let me shift actually into English so our professors understand too. And I would better not, but that's okay, because I wanted to explain how we decided to do it here. Obviously, we have all of the classes at Lectorium at the Ukrainian Catholic University, and we were discussing with Valentina, who is here, who is managing the school now of public management, Ukrainian Catholic University, were to have the event, and she says, let's have it in Lectorium because it's convenient, because it's there, and everybody's there, and it's a big place, and say, look, let's get people out. You know, and I said, for example, italijski dvorek, Italian yard. And she writes to me in 3 hours, and she says, I already confirmed and prepaid. I said, wait a minute, there was a joke. But anyway, here we are. And that's a good place. And actually, well, 2 days ago, we realized that it will be raining the whole day. And we have to start fast and actually speak fast, too, that hopefully there will be no rain, and there is no rain. It's good to be in the Catholic University, you know? So we had a special request today. Well, anyway, it's a great pleasure. I told our guests from other countries and other cities that, I mean, of course, people from Lviv know the story. This was built by Greek merchant, this place. And he invited two Italian architects who built the yard. And, well, he was collecting taxes, I understand, on behalf of the king. So today's topic of conversation probably was relevant back, from, what was that, 400, 500 years ago. And I can only imagine these types of conversations and meetings happening here almost all the time, a part of, what was that, roughly 45 years, 50 years of communist regime that, you know, other issues were discussed or not discussed here, I don't know. But here we are back in the international team. We have American professors. We have Ukrainian, Georgian, Polish participants. And I don't even know, you know, what other nations we have here in the classroom. And I know you all are waiting for me to disappear and to, for Professor Fukuyama to appear. But let me tell you one more joke, you know. No, actually, I have to do one more thing, which is very important, is to, of course, thank our partners. I would like to thank CIPE, Center for International Private Entrepreneurship, Enterprise, excuse me, and the National Endowment for Democracy. I would like to thank Rodinna Kovbaska, which is Barkom, Ukrainian company. I would like to thank FEST, which is another Ukrainian company, our dear good friends that are supporting us. Western NAS Enterprise Fund supports School of Public Management, Ukrainian Catholic University. So thanks to all of them, we have this event too. And let's proceed, Professor Fukuyama. People were coming, Professor, you wouldn't believe, or maybe you would believe, people were standing here and for some reason not all of them got registration. Now they're in, we allowed everybody in. Don't tell everybody, okay? Don't put this on Facebook, okay? By the way, there is a intranet broadcasting, so people can watch it here. But people came, some person said, I came from Chernivtsi, which is 250 kilometers from here. Another person said, I came from Kyiv, 550 kilometers to here to Professor Fukuyama. I will just say one sentence. It is number one professor of political science in the world, eminent thinker, very good friend of Ukraine, and I'm quite sure a very good friend of Lviv City too. Professor Fukuyama, please welcome.
Thank you very much, Pavlo. It's a great pleasure to be here as a guest doing this course at the Ukrainian Catholic University. I would like to thank the same set of sponsors, especially the Center for International Private Enterprise, which has been very generous in supporting our program this week. And I'd like to thank all of you for coming and attending. So what I thought I would do today is to begin by giving you a kind of overview of where I think the world stands and how the world has changed in terms of global politics over the last few years. Then go on to, I actually want to talk a little bit about my country, the United States, because I think we are participating in some of these global trends in ways that I find very unexpected. And then speak a little bit about the issues that you are confronting here in Ukraine, and then look forward to the other people on the panel, my colleague Kent Weaver, Pavlo, and Mustafa Naim, my good friend. So let me begin by talking about the trends in world politics, beginning with the fall of the Berlin Wall. So I guess yesterday or earlier this week was the 25th anniversary of the attempted coup in the former Soviet Union that could have set back the entire collapse of communism, which fortunately fell apart and led immediately to the referendum and then the independence of your country, the Ukraine, back in 1991, which was a really momentous event that now seems like it's ancient history. That event was part of what Samuel Huntington, the great political scientist, called the third wave of democratization, which was a period in which democracies went from about 35 or 40 countries around the world to currently approximately 113. Something over 100 countries now hold something like democratic elections, and we've gone from about a third of countries in the world being democratic to about two-thirds. So this is a really big, momentous movement in world politics, but it's also now meeting a reverse wave. My colleague at Stanford, Larry Diamond, calls this a democratic recession. For 10 years now, the scores of Freedom House, the organization that measures democracy and freedom around the world, have shown a decline in democracy scores. And this is something that, in a certain sense, is better described qualitatively than quantitatively. Qualitatively, the leading democracies in the world do not look like they're doing as well. The United States and Europe both underwent serious financial crises leading to recessions and then low economic growth, seemingly stagnant economic prospects in the last decade. The United States, I think, compounded this by making some important foreign policy mistakes, especially the invasion of Iraq back in 2003. But beyond this, there's a new self-confidence among authoritarian regimes whose consequences I think you are experiencing here in Ukraine. Russia recovered its self-confidence under Vladimir Putin. He has created a nationalistic, aggressive form of semi-authoritarian or quasi-democratic government, which has territorial ambitions and, despite low oil prices, continues to exert a lot of pressure on all of Russia's neighbors. Xi Jinping's China has tightened up its form of authoritarian government, combined with a very successful form of capitalism, to produce what in another 10 or 15 years could be the largest economy in the world. So either end of Eurasia is bookended by two authoritarian, self-confident expansionist regimes. The other big divide in the world right now is, so I guess this is an important broader point. in the Cold War, we understood the fundamental division in the world to be between liberal democracies with market economies and centralized authoritarian or totalitarian regimes with centralized command economies. Today, the world is actually a lot more complicated than that. I think the fight between democracy and authoritarian government continues to be an important dividing line, but in a certain sense, the terrain of the battle has shifted. And I would say that in many respects, the big dividing line is in a certain way not so much between democracy and authoritarianism as between governments that I would describe as basically patrimonial and those that are modern. And by patrimonial, I mean the following. A patrimonial government, maybe it may hold democratic elections the way that Russia does, but the government is fundamentally run for the benefit of the insiders. It seems to me that that is really the essence of that regime, that it sustains itself because the resources of the state are divided among a relatively small elite that use political power to bolster their own personal financial positions, and they use their personal financial positions to bolster their political power. That's the kind of regime we're dealing with. And I would say that that was the kind of regime that President Yanukovych created here in Ukraine. And that is, I think, what your Maidan revolution was really about, because the fundamental choice that you faced, as many other countries in this region, again, is, you know, in a way, not really about democracy. It is about whether you want to live in a patrimonial society where the state is personal property of the rulers, or whether you want to live in a modern society that has an impersonal government and that treats its citizens with a certain degree of equal respect and on the basis of their citizenship. And I think that it is actually that the quality of that state, the quality of that government, that is the, you know, the real fight that we are having in the world today. Because, as I just said, a lot of countries hold elections. A lot of countries legitimate their rulers through some form of democracy. Obviously, in Russia, it's manipulated, it's not fair, there's not a level playing field. But it's also the case that you know, President Putin is probably very popular in that country. The other really big issue has to do with whether our societies are open and are based on a rule of law, on a fundamental rule of law. And that is the other really disturbing new development out there in the world today, that there's a rise of a democratic but intolerant form of nationalism that has begun to infect one country after another. So again, I'm picking on Mr. Putin for a good reason, but he's probably the best example. But you see this in a lot of neighboring countries. You see that in Mr. Erdogan's rule in Turkey. You see that even in a number of democratic countries. So I would say that Prime Minister Abe and Prime Minister Modi in India are also proponents of a certain kind of nationalism based on religion, based on ethnicity, that is not open and tolerant to the rest of the world as a proper liberal democracy ought to be. We see this in the European Union. There's now a rising tide of illiberal populist parties in France, in Germany, in Scandinavia, in many other European countries. And I'm saving my own country for last. We are seeing this, unfortunately, in the United States with the rise of Donald Trump, whose slogan in this election campaign is America first. You know, America for Americans. And I think that it's this kind of erosion of liberal values and ultimately of the rule of law that is really insidiously infecting many countries around the world. Now, why is this going on? I think there's a lot of different, very complex causes to this, but one has to do with economics and society, because a lot of the support for this kind of intolerant nationalistic politics, I think, is a response to the kind of globalization that we've seen over the past 40 years. If you look at the period between 1970 and the American financial crisis in 2008, the global output of the world economy increased 4 times. This involved the rise of China, the rise of India, growth in Europe, growth in the United States. Basically, there hasn't been a single region of the world, Africa, Asia, Latin America, every single one of these regions has seen increases in per capita income that in many cases has driven hundreds of millions of people into the middle class, taken them out of poverty, and so there's been an extremely positive economic story that has been experienced by many, many people around the world. And the reason for this is, in fact, the globalization of the world economy, the fact that trade and investment and the flows of people, money, ideas, has increased over that period. The problem, of course, is that not everybody has benefited to the same extent from this new open globalized world to nearly the same extent. And you see that showing up in the patterns of support for nationalistic politicians, that almost everywhere those nationalists have been supported by people that were basically the losers of globalization. Our trade theory, if you take a basic international economics course, says that everybody gets richer as a result of free trade and flows of investment. But that same theory also says that not everybody within the same society benefits to an equal extent. And in fact, a number of people, particularly those who are less mobile, who have lower skills, less education, are not going to benefit. And if you go to the United States, that is exactly the core support for Donald Trump. His supporters are people with a high school education or less. This is the core of the old working class in the United States. And a lot of those people have really not done well. They've lost income, they've lost social status, their communities are crumbling. And for that group of people, when he says, make America great again, you know, it has a real meaning because for them, life hasn't been so great. And I think, you know, if you look at the support for Marine Le Pen or a lot of the other populist parties in Europe, you see a similar kind of phenomenon. It's not the best educated, most connected people, the most technologically empowered people that support these parties. It tends to be people that are of a lower educational level and oftentimes less urban and so forth. Again, you know, if you go to this part of the world, that's exactly Putin's social base. In St. Petersburg and Moscow, he's very unpopular. That was the source of the demonstrations after his re-election as president several years ago, back in, when was it, 2013. His base of support are really, you know, people that live in smaller cities, out in the countryside, and the like. If you look at Viktor Orban, wonderful Mr. Orban in Hungary, who has pioneered the concept of illiberal democracy, Again, you know, he's not popular in Budapest. He's popular, you know, in the countryside, and again among that same strata of people. And I think that this is one of the issues in terms of public policy that we've really got to figure out, because I think that the pure, you know, so-called neoliberal approach to trade and investment, although it did produce these enormous aggregate benefits for populations, didn't solve the social problem of how to take care of the losers, of the people that were doing less well. And as a result, we have a big political problem. We have a big political problem, I think, in all of our countries in terms of growing social inequality, and most importantly, in terms of the political backlash that that inequality produces. The other, you know, big issue, I think, so let me move on to speak a little bit more specifically about your country and my feeling about the the developments here, because the other thing that's been missing from our politics in many democracies is actually related to the quality of government and the basic ability of democratic governments to deliver not just freedom from bad leaders and tyrannical regimes, but to actually deliver the kinds of services and basic public goods that citizens expect from their societies. Now, as Pavlo was saying, I have been a very close follower of events in your country. I was thrilled at the original Orange Revolution back in 2004, and I was extremely disappointed in the consequences of the Orange Revolution, and it seemed to me that that was a demonstration of the importance of quality of democratic government, because a lot of energy from a lot of young people here in this country went into getting rid of Mr. Yanukovych the first time, but that did not translate into an effective government that was free of corruption, that could deliver basic services to the Ukrainian people, and that was the reason that the Orange Revolution failed in the eyes of many people, and why Mr. Yanukovych was reelected. And I think that the second revolution, the Maidan Revolution, it's really critical for, you know, I think really genuinely for world politics, that it succeed where the Orange Revolution failed, and it's going to stand or fall over this issue of governance and corruption. I think that there are several components, you know, so Kent Weaver and I are teaching a course here at the Catholic University of Ukraine, a lot of which is going to focus on improving public policy and dealing with issues like corruption. And the lessons that I draw from looking at the fight against corruption in other countries, beginning with the United States, is that it is fundamentally a political act, that corruption does not exist as a result of ignorance or officials not knowing what good government looks like. I think most people in most societies understand that corruption is a bad thing, that societies do not function well when their top officials are stealing billions of, you know, dollars or euros from the public treasury. The problem is that it's deeply embedded because it is precisely in the self-interest of elites to steal. It's in the self-interest of elites to steal, and it is not going to end until the political conditions are created to change their incentives, to get them out of power and to put other people in power that have a different set of values, and to create institutions that create different incentives for a whole new generation to take power. And that doesn't happen without really, I think, a combination of three interconnected things. So the first is that you need a grassroots movement. You need civil society. You need people, ordinary citizens, who are outraged at the idea that their politicians are behaving in this kind of a predatory manner. You need good leadership from the top that can shape and organize a grassroots movement. And then you need a reform of institutions to change those incentives. So one of the issues we were discussing in our class today, you know, has to do with pay of public officials. So if your police are being paid less than the average salary in the country, it's very hard to motivate them properly, you know, to not take bribes and to do their jobs like professionals. And so you need those three. You need the grassroots movement, you need the leadership, and you need the right institutions. And the right institutions depend on having a correct idea about what kind of a modern society you want to see emerge at the end of this political reform process. Now, Ukraine is really lucky, I think, in many ways, because the first of those exists. Ukraine, you know, this is one of the biggest surprises to me that came out of the Orange Revolution, is that civil society here is incredible. It's powerful, it's organized, people get angry, people are willing to risk their lives going out into the streets and demonstrating. I think that you also potentially have the right leaders. A lot of those leaders do come out of civil society, but this is a very well-educated country. This is a society in which you've got elites that, you know, really know what the right thing to do is. You've got institutions that are in certain ways deeply defective, but they are, you know, subject to and potentially capable of change. And so what I have been arguing is that you've got to move from the areas of strength to the areas of weakness, and that means shifting the focus of attention away from simply opposing a bad government to actually trying to go into the government and trying to reshape it. And that's something that I think has met with a lot of resistance, because if you live in a bad political system, you live in a predatory, patrimonial political system, everybody has the idea that all politicians are corrupt, that the system is so deeply flawed that there is nothing that ordinary people can do about it. And I guarantee you that if that is your continuing attitude, and that people therefore stay away from democratic politics as a result of that attitude, then nothing is going to change. Nothing is going to change. And so I'm happy, you know, that a number of people have taken up that challenge of actually trying to take the reins of democratic government and to do things about it, because that ultimately, I think, is the hope. If we had more time, I would tell you this long story about the United States in the progressive era, where the U.S. was dealing with endemic corruption in its political system. And, you know, in that story, it took about 40 years for this pervasive corruption to really end. It wasn't even one generation that accomplished it. It was really more like two generations. I suspect it's not going to take nearly that long in this country, because you have outside support, you have a more mobilized society, you've got, in a sense, earlier lessons from other countries that you can take advantage of, which the United States did not have in the 19th century. But I guess I want to just conclude by saying a lot of people in many parts of the world are watching what goes on here, because your ability to actually take control of your own society, I think will be an important model and an inspiration for other people around the world. And given that rise of a kind of ugly, closed, nationalistic, corrupt, patrimonial government, you know, in different forms, it's a big struggle that we are all in together. It turns out that Russia and Ukraine have been playing a role in American presidential politics in the last couple of weeks. So we really are in this all together. So thank you very much for listening, and I look forward to the comments of other people on the panel, and I look forward to the rest of the week here in Lviv. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Fukuyama, first of all, and let's reflect a little bit. You know, let's think, let's debate, and you will have an opportunity to ask your questions. But before that, as a part of reflection, I would like to invite Professor Kent Weaver, who is co-teaching the course at the School of Public Management, Ukrainian Catholic University, for the faculty from number of institutions in Ukraine, Georgia, here in Lviv. And he's the professor at Georgetown University, which is Washington, D.C., and the senior fellow at the Brookings Institution, and has a number of books, and I want to be precise here because I mean, these are important issues. Do institutions matter? Ending welfare as we know it, automatic government, and the politics of industrial change. Is that, if it's wrong, then blame the Wikipedia. But I hope it was correct. Well, anyway, Professor Weaver, reflecting on Professor Fukuyama's remarks, and maybe given your thinking about institutions, should we develop maybe this topic, and then if you want to venture into something else, of course, and institutions, corruptions and institutions. please come in here. How do we tackle corruption, and how do we build the institution that tackle corruption? Okay. Is it?
Thanks very much. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you to the sponsors. So I know most of you came here to hear Frank, and I don't blame you. And so I will try to be brief in my comments. And I also lack Frank's deep knowledge of the Ukraine. So I'm going to try to make six comments or six general points about corruption and anti-corruption efforts, which hopefully will stimulate discussion as we go along. The first major point is that corruption isn't a single phenomenon. Corruption is, in fact, many phenomena that have very different roots. So it's petty bribery, of in everyday transactions like to traffic police. It's embezzlement of state resources. It's bid rigging in public procurement. It's purchasing and selling of jobs. And these are very different phenomena. They're very different in terms of the willingness of people to participate in those phenomena. They're different in the ability to monitor those phenomena and in how easy it is to get around those phenomena. So again, it's not a single phenomenon. It's multiple phenomena that have different roots. So my second point is that anti-corruption, you shouldn't think in terms of an anti-corruption strategy. You need to have multiple anti-corruption strategies that are based on, you know, what are the underlying causes of this particular kind of corruption. So what are some of the underlying causes of corruption? And again, different corruption phenomena have different underlying causes. One is information asymmetry. So people may not know who are trying to get state services, what kinds of services they're entitled to. The lack of choice is another root cause of corruption, that individuals may, in order to get state services, have to deal with bureaucrats who are essentially monopoly providers to them. They have no choice over those. Third is resource problems. As Frank mentioned, if the police are very poorly paid, then it's not very surprising that you're going to get police corruption. There are autonomy problems. Sometimes the people who are engaged in corruption don't want to be engaged in corruption, but they really see no alternative. So the most famous example, I think, is in Mexico, where the anti-drug police face the dilemma of what's called plata o plomo, which means silver or lead in Spanish. So the drug cartels say to them, you can take our money and be corrupt, or we will kill you. Well, how do you address those sorts of problems? Peer effects are another source of corruption. Again, particularly in the sort of petty corruption. If you think that everyone else is engaged in corruption, then, and I will pay a very heavy cost not to be corrupt, that you know, it's very difficult to tell people, well, don't pay bribes in order to get a government contract if you think, well, I'll never get another government contract again. So again, you need to think about what the individual barriers are. My third point is that you need to tailor your solutions to the kinds of underlying causes of specific kinds of corruption. If it's a resource problem, the police aren't being paid enough, then you need to pay them more. If it's a monitoring problem, that it's very difficult to see the corrupt behavior and stop it, then you need to think of smarter ways, often using technology, to address those. So things like checking government records against each other. So if somebody has a very low declared income and lots of property, well, there's probably an indicator there that there's some kind of corruption. Consumers who are trying to get government services, think of ways to give them more choices so they aren't faced with monopoly suppliers. So say you can go to several government offices or use e-governance as a way to end that sort of monopoly control over providers. So again, think about tailoring your strategies to the particular causes of a particular kind of corruption. A fourth point I want to make is that governments need to identify the most mission-critical kinds of corruption. In other words, if our goal is to increase economic growth, if our objective is, let's say, to improve the investment climate, what are the corrupt behaviors that we need to address most to get around that problem and devote more resources to those mission-critical kinds of behavior. A fifth general point is to think about the long term and multiple phases in your anti-corruption strategy. Don't just say, well, we've got to do this now. Think about, what do we do first with the resources we've got available? What do we do second? And what do we do third? And here I want to cite the example of Singapore, now seen as one of the least corrupt societies in the world, least corrupt governments. It used to be an incredibly corrupt system. So what did Singapore do? They didn't do everything all at once. They started off by increasing the power of their anti-corruption commission. Second thing they did after that was to increase the penalties for corruption. And a third thing they did when they became a wealthier society was they increased the pay of government officials. So it wasn't all done at once. It was done by prioritizing and thinking in terms of multiple phases. The last point I want to make about corruption is that sometimes the problem with corruption isn't just the people who are being corrupt. It's the policies that are in place. So my favorite example here is a system I worked on a lot, the public distribution system in India for basic commodities, which buys commodities from farmers above the market price and sells them to consumers at below the market price. And, you know, in that sort of situation, there are enormous incentives for corruption. And I mentioned this to some Indians, and they said, yes, there's an old Indian proverb that says, where there is honey, there will be flies. So a last piece of advice is think about, in some cases, changing the policy to get rid of the honey, and that will help you get rid of the flies. So
Thank you, Professor. Please go there. And I have, okay, here's the translation. Well, I don't know, was that a, I mean, that was a great global introduction to an overview of corruption, as if we need one, knowing that we have some practical peculiarities here. But thank you, Professor, and especially, you know, the recipes. Now, how should I introduce Mustafa? You have these conflicting ideas. The person who knows, as a journalist, as now as an MP, who knows the peculiarities of the Ukrainian ways of mishandling the system. You see, I'm looking for words. But I would rather introduce him, and we found this word, because I want to say student, disciple, but he said follower is probably the best word of Professor Fukuyama. And Professor Fukuyama talked about Mustafa, with Mustafa not being in the room. It was in Tbilisi. I was invited by Professor to the Leadership Academy for Development in Georgia, and Mustafa was mentioned a number of times to the Georgian audience. And by the way, Kamachoba to our Georgian friends here. Hello. Mustafa Nayem, everybody knows him, so he is here.
Thank you, Pavlo. Thank you, everyone. It is a big honor for me to be here with you, because I never even dream about that. But as far as we are in Ukraine, and I am a member of Parliament of Ukraine, I will try to proceed my speech in Ukrainian language, if you don't mind. Доброго вечора. По-перше, для мене дуже велика честь, і дійсно я дозволю собі пригадати події минулорічного, тобто дворічної давнини, коли ми вперше зустрілись з паном Фукуямою в Стенфорді. Я тоді ще був журналістом, і з першої лекції вона була така порівняльний аналіз дуже багатьох країн, в яких проходили такі події, як Майдан. Це була, такі країни були як Туніс, Єгипет, згадувалась Україна. І ключовою думкою пана Фукуями, яка підтверджувалась книжками пана Хантінгтона, була про те, що якщо соціальна мобілізація не конвертується в політичні дії, в політичну активність, то це провал. Провал тих подій, які були на вулицях. Як журналіст, як тоді вже активіст, для мене було це яким таким шоком. Тобто, як так? Ми щось зробили, ми їх змусили піти, зараз прийшла інша влада, і так сталося, що ми зараз програємо тільки тому, що ми самі не пішли в політику. Чесно кажучи, наступні два тижні я був в внутрішній дискусії з собою, ми потім говорили з паном Фукуямою декілька разів, і зрештою це завершилось великим інтерв'ю, але вже тоді я почав спілкуватися з нашими колегами в Україні, які були з Сергієм Лещенком, Світланою Заліщук, з Єгором Соболєв, з Андрієм Шевченком, про те, як далі рухатись. І якщо чесно, я можу сказати, що це такі два всесвіти – політичний і неполітичний. Сказати, що той чи інший вибір був правильний, я зараз не можу. Я не впевнений в тому, що треба робити такий вибір або такий вибір. Але я впевнений в іншому. В тому, що ті слова, які пан Фукуяма тоді мені сказав, і це не намагання зробити якийсь культ особи, а це дійсно було так. Головне було про те, що коли ви туди підете, ваші руки будуть дуже брудними. І зрештою, мені здається, це подорослішання до нас прийшло лише зараз. Тому що тоді ми дуже хотіли бути чистими. Нам дуже було зручно бути чистими на правій стороні. Дуже багато людей, які тут стоять, вони відчувають себе на правій стороні. Це дуже-дуже зручно. І насправді в мене ностальгія за тими часами, коли я завжди був на правій стороні, коли я завжди казав правду, коли я завжди говорив те, як потрібно, коли я завжди вимагав робити те, як правильно в ідеальному світі. А сам опиняєшся зараз в ситуації, коли немає правильних виходів. Сам ти опиняєшся в світі, коли ти змушений домовлятися з людьми, про яких ти говорив дуже багато років, що вони корупціонери. Ти змушений йти на якісь кроки, які так чи інакше назвуть тебе зрадником тих чи інших інтересів. Але це такий, знаєте, як level up. Тому що тут ти починаєш задумуватися не просто бути на правильній стороні, а ще й з внутрішньою мотивацією про те, чому ти на цій стороні. Це про те, про що ми багато з нас не думаємо. Тому що багато з нас думає про те, що як їм зручно правильно бути на цій стороні. Коли ти стаєш політиком, ти зрештою кажеш про те, що дивіться, я знаю, як краще. І це твоя відповідальність, це твоя карма. Коли ти кажеш, що я знаю, як краще, ти вже не маєш права приховувати свої мотиви, приховувати свої статки, приховувати своє життя. Ти змушений йти робити, навіть якщо це попри твої інтереси особисті або родинні. І якщо вже через 2 роки подивитись те, що відбувається в Україні, рефлектуючи те, що сказали професори, я можу сказати, що навіть попри ту ситуацію, яка є в країні, попри те, що відбулося за останні 2 роки, а більше того, за те, що сталося за останні півроки, тому що для мене це таке дуже великий удар по моїй свідомості, після подій, як ми не відправили відставку пана Яценюка і пана Шокіна, і це було відверте таке шулерство, да, того, що відбулося в парламенті, з усіх боків. Я не буду зараз говорити поганих чи добрих. Так от, попри це все, я можу сказати, що дійсно 2 роки назад ми зробили правильний крок, і ми перемогли. Я поясню, чому. Почекайте. Справа в тому, що зараз є в країні фактичні лідери. Ті люди, яких є повноваження. Ті люди, які за законом керують країною. Президент, прем'єр-міністр, генеральний прокурор, голова парламенту, міністри і так далі. Всі ці люди дійсно мають повноваження влади. Але давайте я вам наведу приклад, порівняння, з яким ви зрозумієте, хто насправді лідер. Уявіть собі, що в нас є армія, на чолі якої полководець, який веде всіх на війну. Всі ми хочемо перемоги. Ви можете собі уявити, що в цій війні полководець хоче перемоги менше, ніж хтось з солдатів. Це неможливо. Ми живемо в країні, в якій конкретний підрозділ цієї армії, конкретне, я не знаю, взвод або бригада, яка хоче більше перемоги, ніж полководець, яка змушена воювати з полководцем, з його інертністю, з його несвідомістю, заради того, щоб побудувати нові мости, нову зброю і перемогти цього ворога. Коли я зараз кажу ворога, я маю на увазі в першу чергу корупцію, тому що це те, що роз'їло нашу державу до коріння і те, що призвело до війни. Так от в цій ситуації, в цій війні, лідер не полководець, хоча він має повноваження. Лідер – ті люди, які більше, ніж він хоче перемоги. Лідер завжди той, хто хоче перемоги більше. Хто в цій країні більше хоче перемоги, ніж президент, прем'єр-міністр, голова парламенту, уряд і ті люди, які зараз тримають владу і фактично мають цю владу? Це громадянське суспільство? Це журналісти? Це ті білі ворони в системі, які зараз опинились в парламенті? Це антикорупційне бюро? Це нова поліція? Ці люди є лідерами системи. Насправді, за 2 роки ми це змінили. Що ми створили на Майдані? Ми змусили їх слухати тих, хто хоче більше перемоги. Це найбільше наше досягнення. І я вважаю, що якщо б ми 2 роки тому всі ті люди, які пішли в систему, вагались і не пішли, і думали про те, що ну нас не так про нас кажуть, нас засудять, ми програли тоді. Ми виграли по одній причині, що ми змусили нас слухати. І зрештою, щодня, сьогодні, на екранах телебачення, в новинах, в парламенті, у всіх кабінетах тренди створюєте ви. Тому що вони зараз чинять опір. Головна робота влади зараз чинити опір, тому що хоче суспільство. Левова частина того, що зараз робить влада, це намагатись спустити пар, заспокоїти суспільство не тим, що вони роблять щось, а показати, що вони щось роблять. Чи це погано, чи добре? Мені здається, що це добре. Так, ми розуміємо, але головне, що ми це розуміємо. Ми граємо в цю гру. Ця гра триває доти, доки вони мають ці ресурси. Гроші, вік, натхнення, ресурси, адміністративний апарат і так далі. Але ми вже в цій країні взяли на себе відповідальність. Ми вже керуємо цією країною. Ми вже фактично створюємо тренди. Хто зараз в країні створює тренди? Хіба президент? Подивіться, що відбувається. Хіба уряд створює тренди? Хіба парламент створює тренди? Тренди створює суспільство, яке тисне на парламент, тисне на уряд, тисне на президента, і ми змушені, погоджуючи ці тренди, виходити на них піаритись. Так діє ця влада. Чому це погано? Тому що насправді після Майдану ми очікували, що ця влада буде набагато краще, ніж те, що ми мали раніше. Чи це вона краще насправді? Так, вона краще. Порошенко краще, ніж Янукович, Ющенко і Кучма. Гройсман точно краще, ніж Азаров. Парубій точно краще, ніж пан Рибак, який був до того. Проблема головна в тому, що ми не хочемо їх більше порівнювати з тими, хто було раніше. Ми хочемо їх порівнювати з тими, кого від них ми очікували. І в цій війні вони програють. Тому я дуже вдячний і тим людям, які були в Стенфорді, які нас надихали, і тим людям, які нас підтримували. І закликаю і далі. Попри те, що ви бачите дуже багато зневіри, попри те, що ви бачите дуже багато песимізму, попри те, що відбувається, зрозуміти одну річ. Я впевнений, що через 10 років, 15 років ми озирнемось назад, і це будуть історичні часи, коли в нас будуть два вибори. Перший. Сказати, що нічого не буде, тому що були вже свідками поразок. Сказати, що вони всі однакові. Сказати, що все провалено, що ми програли. І другий шлях, і вибір, який стоїть і перед вами, і перед всією країною. Обрати в системі тих людей, які дійсно взяли на себе відповідальність, які дійсно щось можуть. І не довіряючи їм сліпо, перевіряючи щодня, підтримати їх, щоб їх стало більше, щоб через 10 років ми не сказали, ви знаєте, ми програли тільки тому, що ми зневірились, тому що в нас не було довіри. Дякую вам дуже, дякую пану Фукуямі, дякую пану Віверу. Ви для нас люди, які розказуєте, як це відбувається в інших країнах. І насправді мені здається, що і сьогоднішня дискусія у Львові, і те, що буде відбуватися в Києві наступного тижня, це можливість все ж таки зазирнути в реальність, яку ми, можливо, не бачили. Ну і головне, я всіх вітаю з Днем Незалежності. 25 років тому наша країна народила дійсно незалежною. Сьогодні щодня ми святкуємо цю незалежність. І мені здається, я скажу чесно про себе, в мене вперше в житті, коли ти відчуваєш, що дійсно ця незалежність тобі дісталась не просто згори, а ти її виборов чимось. Тим, що ми дійсно, хтось брат, хтось син, хтось батько, або стояв на Майдані, або зараз на фронті, або працює в уряді. Це одна та сама робота. Але ми це все вибороли. Давайте це не здамо. Давайте не дамо їм розраховувати на наш відчай і зневіру. Дякую вам дуже.
Ну, це справді вийшли такі роздуми. Я продовжу. I will continue in Ukrainian. Які, напевно, такі варті цього дворика якраз, бо це такий, знаєте, серце, поклики серця в голос. У нас є ще мікрофони? Добре. Ваші запитання трьом спікерам. Юрій Підлісний, прошу.
I have a question to Professor Fukuyama. You mentioned in your speech that different countries, as example, you took several of them, Russia, France, Hungary, Turkey, that face now another kind of development to the authoritarianism and nationalism. Some populist movement are born in different countries. And that besides the democratization of the different countries, whom should we blame for this trend in the modern politics? Should we blame politicians, institutions, some decision makers, or the values that stand beside these decision makers?
Well, I think that there are a number of people to blame, but it's also a very complex question. So populism doesn't have a clear definition. It's anti-elite. It's a negative name that elites give to popular opposition, but sometimes they deserve it. And, you know, in a certain way, the elites in both the United States and in Europe, by creating the financial crisis in the US and by creating the euro crisis in Europe, and now this immigration crisis that has happened since last year, are to some extent responsible for bringing on really big problems that hurt not the elites but ordinary people in all of those societies. On the other hand, I think a lot of the negative impacts and the economic changes that have been going on are really not something you can blame on any class or individual. A lot of it is you have to blame on technology. So in Silicon Valley, where I live, they're busy developing driverless cars, which are going to be here much sooner than anyone realizes. And you think about the driverless car and how many taxi drivers and chauffeurs are going to be out of work as a result of this technological change. It's going to hurt people, but who do you blame for that? Do you blame Google or, you know, the Ford Motor Company? You know, it's very hard to single out someone for this. If you want to really blame anyone, I think that the people that deserve it most are political entrepreneurs who sense that there is a big opportunity in exacerbating the fears and prejudices that people have but normally try to keep under control because, you know, that's the norm in their society. And they realize that they can make a lot of political capital by violating those norms and by exacerbating those fears. So one of the greatest, you know, entrepreneurs in this sense was Slobodan Milosevic in Serbia, who saw that there was a big opportunity for Serbian nationalism. I think Donald Trump has been completely shameless in his willingness to exaggerate fears that people have of immigration and of globalization. And, you know, Putin has also realized that there's a big opening for this kind of aggressive nationalism. His ratings, you know, went up substantially after he grabbed Crimea because he saw that this was a good, ploy that he could use. So I guess there's not a single, you know, there's not a single person you could blame, but in moral terms, I would say I would concentrate your fire on those, that kind of political entrepreneurship.
Sandra?
Hey, Professor, my question to Professor Fukuyama. Professor, you told about this new political trend, about this nationalism, anti-democratic trends, dictatorship. On your estimation, how far it would go? Would we meet new era of, you know, nationalism, empires, or what?
Well, I believe in political agency, meaning that I actually think that these structural forces like globalization and these social classes that I think are behind a lot of this populist anger are not inevitable trends that, you know, operate despite individual choices made by political leaders. And therefore, I think that it's really uncertain how far things will go. So, for example, in the United States, I don't think that Donald Trump is going to win the election. In fact, if I had to make a prediction, it's that Hillary Clinton will win in a landslide. The Republicans will lose control of the Senate, that they'll lose a lot of ground in the House, and that there will be a pretty firm repudiation of the kind of politics that he stands for. In Europe, it's a little bit harder to tell where this is going to go because I think, you know, there's a kind of vacuum of strong leadership in the right places in Europe. But again, that's not something that inevitably is going to snowball into a unstoppable populist movement. And it requires a lot of adjustment in terms of policy. And so part of that means meeting the legitimate fears of these publics that have been negatively impacted by globalization and cultural change, and actually doing something to, you know, address some of those fears. So short answer is, I don't know what the answer is, but I absolutely do not believe that it's inevitable that this problem will get worse. And I do think it's important for all of us to recognize that a lot of good things have been going on around the world to counter those trends, that there have been democratic movements in this country, in Sri Lanka, in Burma, in other parts of the world that, mean that the popular demand for democracy is not by any means exhausted.
Professor Weaver?
So I largely agree with Frank's comments, although I'm a bit more pessimistic than he is, especially about the United States. I don't think that Donald Trump will get elected. But I do think what we're likely to see in the United States is a continuation of the kind of gridlock, because we will almost certainly continue to have divided government in an extremely partisan, poisonous environment within Congress that is likely to further the frustration of the American public because public problems aren't being addressed. So there's currently an outbreak of the Zika virus in Miami, which many of you read about. You would think this would be a really, really easy problem for Congress to throw some money at and say, look at what we've done to try to resolve the problem. They haven't even been able to do that. I am not very pessimistic about the capacity of the American government in the short and medium term to demonstrate an ability to do things that will weaken the populist anger that we see. But at least the good news is, no, I don't think Donald Trump will get elected.
Mustafa, чи буде Дональд Трамп вибраний президентом?
I will be short. We did everything him not to be elected. But I think that
Олег Володимирович,
these days the biggest friend of Hillary Clinton is Mr. Yanukovych, who discredited Manafort for all his life. But from the other side, what we should be very clear is that Manafort worked in the United States for decades. And before that, he helped many dictators. And Yanukovych is only one evidence in which he can be jailed or prosecuted. And it's very sad about justice in the United States. Because before that, he helped Marcos. Before that, he helped Angola dictatorships. And it was so evident and so obvious, but he did it. So it's about the United States also. But I think and I hope, I'm convinced that Clinton and family of Clinton will win again, because before that, Manafort helped Dole, who actually lost election to Mr. William Clinton.
Mustafa, добре, а популізм в Україні?
I think populists in Ukraine has more chance than Trump in the United States, unfortunately. But you know, I think the populism is the one of our illness, and my expectation from Ukraine people is that from last 2 years they get more conscious than before. Just remember that how people of Ukraine, they raised up to protect police near the parliament. It's the same police which attacked Maidan just 3 years ago, just because they are conscious. They can estimate who is right and who is wrong. So I think that populism is our illness. We should fight it. But from the other side, the weakness of power today, this is the chance for populists. And I hope that power, I mean those who are running country now, will recognize real problem. The real problem is not populist. The real problem is not civil society. The real problem is not enemy outside. The real problem here in Kyiv. And those people who are now corrupt today, as a, those people who are sitting in prosecutor general, and those who are sitting in parliament, those who are sitting in the administration of president, in government, they are our enemy. Populists just using that. They are not causing new problems. They are using weakness of parliament and emotions of people. So if we allow them, they will win. For me, it's big sad news was when Ljashko, unfortunately I should call him, he had 20% last election. The guy who helped Yanukovych to fight opposition. This is after Maidan, immediately. This is our country, this is our reality. So I hope that we will fight this illness, but without those people who are running country, we will not be able to be successful in that.
Actually, I just wanted to make one point. Anne Applebaum, who was the wife of Radek Sikorsky, she's a journalist. She had this very nice piece saying that Donald Trump is actually the first Russian oligarch in American politics because he uses his money to win in politics and he hopes to use his political position to help his empire, his own business empire. So Russia has been exporting this kind of bad oligarchic character to the United States. And we are very grateful to the Ukrainians who have exposed Paul Manafort and therefore hurt Donald Trump because you're doing a lot to help American democracy.
Yeah. I'm here, unfortunately I cannot stand up. So my question is this. In our strategic process, we came to the conclusions that we have very, very big gap of trust. And everybody is telling here that our main problem is because of business is connected with authority. You see? In your book Trust, you're telling that problem is in post-communist countries that there is no collaboration between commercial companies or business and politician parties. So my question is, what do you mean under this collaboration, especially in the conditions when you are telling that ideology is disappear already and culture is coming instead of? Thank you.
Well, I think basically the only solution to this problem in a place like Ukraine is to strengthen the rule of law by building, you know, the strongest possible independent judicial institutions. The problem here is in a certain way that you have too much trust in a narrow circle, that you have an elite where the businessmen and the politicians all know each other, they work with each other, they help each other, at the expense of the larger society. And you need to break up those small circles of trust and replace it with basically an impersonal government that creates a level playing field for everybody. The only way you do that really is by having a state that is strong enough to really enforce the law equally against all people. And that requires, you know, that independent judiciary, and it also requires the will to enforce the law against people. And that means, you know, you've got to start putting some important people in jail. And until there's a general recognition that the most powerful people in the society are also liable to being punished under the same laws that punish ordinary people, I don't think that people are going to trust the system. They're going to think it's stacked against them, which in fact it is. So the demonstration effect of actually being able to, you know, prosecute some really important, powerful, rich people is, I think, the beginnings of the creation of a system that will be more broadly trusted by ordinary ordinary citizens.
If I may, Frank, you just, I'm Batu Kuteli, I'm from Georgia. You just mentioned that Ukraine is doing a lot to help American democracy, and America is doing a lot to help Ukrainian democracy, but Ukrainians are trying to build their democracy under the Russian gunpoint. So what should be your recommendation to the next US administration? What more they should do to help Ukraine to get the security umbrella to be allowed to do their democratic reform themselves?
So I have, okay, I hope that, I hope I don't get in trouble for this. I have actually never been a supporter of Georgia and Ukraine entering NATO for the following reason, that the essence of NATO, the most important aspect of NATO is the Article 5 security guarantee, where an attack on one country will be an attack on all countries. And the reason that I didn't think that NATO membership was a good idea was that in operational military terms, it's really impossible for the United States to fulfill that pledge. And therefore, we shouldn't promise something that we can't deliver. However, short of that, there's a lot that can be done. And so I think President Obama was wrong in denying military assistance to Ukraine. I think that it would have been a good thing if we had been willing to do this. And I think that Obama suffers from a kind of overreaction to our involvement in Afghanistan and in Iraq, where he really doesn't want to get sucked into, you know, almost anything. I think in that respect, Hillary Clinton will be much more activist and less reluctant to use other forms of American power, including, you know, things like military supplies, training, and so forth, than Obama was. And I hope that she actually makes that change if she's elected president.
Let's have two more questions.
Hi, I have this question to you. I'm a big fan of Hillary Clinton, and she has been accused of many things, including corruption, including money laundering, including cheating people in building scandal, property scandal. And my question is, do you think she and US is a good example for Ukraine as a democracy, and does US have to work on its democracy itself?
Well, Kent can comment on this as well. In my view, Hillary Clinton's problem is the following, that she and Bill Clinton epitomize a certain kind of interest group politics in the United States that is legal, but does not look very good. Basically, you know, that's the politics of pandering to whatever group is willing to support you and offering them, you know, sympathetic policies in return. Again, that's legal in American politics, but it's part of what Americans really dislike, that money buys you access and influence over decision making. The other thing that she really screwed up on was this email scandal, which, you know, I think it's right that she's not being prosecuted for it, but it was a very serious lapse of judgment, which I think speaks to things that people don't like about her, her arrogance, secretiveness, and the like. So that's something American democracy has to fix. There's many people very angry at lobbyists and interest groups and the role of money in the US on both the left and the right. And I think unless we fix that, you're right that America is not going to be a great model for Ukraine or for other democracies. But that is at the same time a couple of levels below the kind of corruption that you see in this country, and certainly that you see in other places, you know, like Russia. You want to?
Yeah, I would just add two things. I'm not such a Hillary Clinton fan, but given the alternatives, you know, I think there are a couple of things. One is that, as Frank mentioned, the role of money in the, in politics in the United States is completely out of control. And in part, that is a result of our Constitution and the way that our Constitution has been interpreted by the courts, which basically says that money is speech, and so it is almost impossible to restrict the role of money in politics. And I think that that has had a tremendously poisonous effect, especially with changes over the last 10 years, which means that there's a lot of dark money going into politics where we really can't tell where it's coming from. So I agree that the United States has many things that make us less than an ideal democracy. And, you know, I actually do not think that, back to Hillary Clinton, the fact that she's had some serious lapses of judgment and some, I would say, relatively minor scandals is just not as important a concern as the fact that, you know, three administrations of Clinton's, if she gets elected, and three administrations of Bush's, I think does also not send good signals about the openness of the very top access to administration, to government offices in the United States. We don't want to become like Argentina.
Okay, you go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Fukuyama, for coming here. My question would be following to what you have already said about catching big fishes. So if we just can make an assumption that political leadership is kind of people who are elected in order to provide certain status quo in society, especially when we have this status quo certainly shaped after Maidan. And for sure, if we have oligarchs, so this political leadership is somehow provided to keep it, this status quo. So my question would be, how actually could we catch those big fishes if this current political leadership was elected in order to maintain the status quo between these oligarchs? Thank you.
Well, I think, so Mustafa and I were discussing this when we were driving over here in the car. The biggest weapon you've got is civil society. I think that it is only the fear that if you don't jail a big fish, that there's going to be another big uprising in the streets. And if your independent court system, you know, if you can get to an independent court system that can actually put them in jail, and then that comes under pressure from the elites, the only protection you've got is civil society. It's the fact that, you know, thousands of people will mobilize in the streets against those elites. I think that that's really the only resource. And in places where you've had effective measures against corruption. That's a really important part of the equation. So I think that political mobilization is something that you ought to hold on to. Don't get tired of it, because you're going to need it, you know, I think, continually down the road.
I want to add something that, you know, these days if you listen to those our leaders and the arguments why they are against us and why we are not right, is they are saying that they're working for Kremlin, they're working for Putin, they look at them, they're politicians, but they're going to the streets, they're protesting. But what happened actually 2 years ago? People brought them to the power. But because they're afraid of destabilization, because they're afraid of their own sins, they're afraid of, you know, to lose the control on the system, they invited to the table not people, not civil society, but oligarchs and shareholders of this corrupt system, which was all those 20 years. And actually the deal is between them. We were spectators of this, you know, this spectacle, yes? So for me, it is obvious that now we should remind them. This is reminding. This is not revolution. It is not attacking them. Remind them, please, guys, your biggest partner should be society. It is much more fruitful to deal with oligarchs. Look what happened with Kolomoisky. They dealt with him 2 years ago. Now he's outside of system and he's fighting Poroshenko himself. 2 years ago, Kolomoisky in the cabinet of president, they deal that they will not attack him. Today, Kolomoisky financing opposition, financing those people who will kill Poroshenko politically. Is that fruitful for him? Not. But if he, 2 years ago, he stand with us in the parliament, in the stage, when we fight Kolomoisky, today we will fight him. Look at the other side, look at Akhmetov. 2 years ago, this guy, afraid of people, afraid of street, afraid of everyone, he hid himself. He was silent. And actually, we had a chance to deal with him in the new rules, showing that, please, everyone is equal. You don't have any monopoly in the energy sector. What we have now? Akhmetov is dictating Poroshenko what to do in an energy sector. Because they deal. It was much more useful for him to deal with us, with civil society, with young politicians, with reformers, but because of his fears, he deal with them. And also Yatsenyuk, and also ministries and leadership upon the country. That is the biggest mistake of our leadership. They deal with those people who are not partners. They deal with players. But we are partners. We eager to fight this corruption. We really want to change country. You and we. But they don't listen to us. What should we do? We are going to the streets. We are asking international society to push Poroshenko like we did during Yanukovych's presidency. It's the same. So we have to go to the streets. We are not able to avoid that just because of one reason. In 2005, we did this mistake. We were on the streets and then we went home and put everything at the table for them. So we should remind them. And the biggest mistake of us in 2005 was just victory in country for democracy cannot be fixed forever. Every day we should go out and fight for that. Every day, every city, every street, and every occasion. And don't listen to those people who are blame you that you're politicians. Policy is not the tool to be enriched. Is the tool to run country. This is difference. When they say you that you are politicians and you are going for policy, yes, we are. But for people, for country, for our values, not for money. And they think that they were blaming us that you are policymakers, that we are thieves or corrupt. No, we are really politicians. They are thieves. They are those people who 25 years used policymaking to enrich themselves. Thank you.
That sounds like a closing statement. And I know there are some people that who want to ask the questions. I think that you can do it individually. Otherwise, I can see people from the balcony who want to go down and already leaving the stage. Well, anyway, let's thank our trio, Professor Fukuyama, Professor Weaver, and Assistant Professor Mustafa Nayem, for their reflections, remarks, observations, ideas, inspiration, energy. And we continue tomorrow at the School of Public Management. So those of you who want to get, you know, by the way, the story that you promised about the fighting the corruption in America, this will be covered in the due time in our courses over there. Otherwise, well, thank you very much once again. Please, давайте подякуємо нашим гостям. Я хочу подякувати вам за ваш час, що в цей гарний літній вечір ви прийшли сюди, в цей прекрасний італійський дворик, подумати про глобальну і українську політику. Я хочу подякувати нашим партнерам ще раз. Центр міжнародного підприємства, Center for International Private Enterprise, National Endowment for Democracy, Borcom і Holden Emotion Fest, і, звичайно, Український католицький університет, школа управління. Дякую.